You find out what opportunities that are there after master's over there. You get in touch over LinkedIn, you just type on Ashwin University on LinkedIn, you find the student alumni, Indian student alumni, and then you can interact with them and look out for the opportunity.
But man kan inte få hela.
Det är inte foto så du bara vrider på så lätt.
Explain the tool to the students.
This trip goes by air to Stockholm from India. And depending on airline.
Important in Sweden isn't really so surprising. Sweden is the sixth largest country in Europe, and if you guys were to tilt it, we're not even a third of the way up. If you were to tilt it on the bottom, you would end up in Africa. That's how long it is.
On Monday afternoon, we started by visiting the Swedish Bar Association, and we met the International Secretary Johan Sangborn. We were informed that an advocate in Sweden must be a member of this Bar Association or he's not allowed to use the title advocate. Theoretically, however, anyone can act as a defender or representative in court to represent someone who has a case in the court. It must not be an advocate. However, in reality, most of the cases are handled by advocates. Advocates must follow certain ethical standards and have certain knowledges to be an advocate, and if they misuse their position, they will lose their title. Last meeting on Monday, we met the legal firm Sirio. It's one of the larger firms in Sweden and originally was a part of an organization with many Swedish offices, but as they are very concentrated on international issues, they have separated and are now at their own company. They have experience from around the globe, including India. And we met Carl Olof Boeng and others, and we had a cocktail invitation there. And we had small talks in small groups, and I learned a lot from them how they were working. And also one of the students after the tour has done his internship here at this company. On Tuesday morning, we went to the Stockholm Chamber of Commerce and we met Mr. Daniel Nutley, who is the international person working with the international relationships between the Chamber and the rest of the world. And he informed us about lots of advantages to be active in Stockholm, as it's a main center in the north of Europe and there are big companies in the field of IT and manufacturing and other areas, and that there are many positive reasons why a company should be active from Stockholm. However, there is one or two issues also that needs to be solved, which the Chamber of Commerce is trying to push for, and one of them is that there is a lack of apartments or living space for people who want to come to Stockholm and be active. So one has to solve the issue of living before the decision of moving to the Stockholm area. And it was very interesting information, and we learned a lot about Stockholm and its advantages. After the Chamber of Commerce, we met a subsidiary to it, that is the Stockholm Arbitration Institute, who belongs to the Stockholm Chamber of Commerce, but is an independent group working within its framework. Our contact is Lise Alm, the head of business development, and we was informed about Arbitration Institute and how it works. And this institute is one of the world's most important because many years ago, the Soviet Union, when it was at its heydays, and the United States of America decided that conflicts between the two parties should be solved at the Stockholm Arbitration Institute. And now, Stockholm Arbitration Institute have many international customers, and they do deal in affairs between countries and in affairs between companies and countries and other issues. And there's a lot of international things going on at this place. Maybe keeps a low profile in a way, not telling what's going on there in detail because that's the party's secret, but it's definitely one important institute when it comes to arbitration. On Tuesday afternoon, after we had our lunch at Meinheimer Svetling, we continued at the same place and was having our seminar. It was started by three speeches from the Mannheimer Swatling company side. They are Sweden's biggest law firm. And it was their side was led by Mr. Andre Andersson, who is the global relationship partner in the company. They informed us about the company as such and the legal environment in Sweden and international work they do and so on. From our side, Ili High Court Justice Sangrit Dingra Segal informed about arbitration in India. And Mr. Robert, that's myself, informed about cultural differences between India and Sweden. On Wednesday, our third day, we visited the Flemingsberg Legal Center, which has four units. First, we met the prosecutor, Karin Tekkonen, from the prosecutor's chamber, and learned about the prosecutor's work in Sweden, which partly is different from India, of course. Then we went to the court, where we met the judge, Karin Paul Bartes, who informed about and showed us the court. Interesting was also that people's views has been asked for, everyone who came there, and based on that they have made from the survey they have made some changes. For instance, on each quarter there was a map, and so if someone has never been in a court, they could show that map and explain where is the judge sitting, where is the defender sitting, where are the advocates, and where is the prosecutor sitting, and so on. They also had clear signs inside the courtroom. They also developed witness reports using layouts for that also.
Sweden has a system which is not like you would say with judges, etc., and not like Indian system with all the judges either, but a combination where we have lay judges. Lay judges are appointed from the municipals, and they are giving a short education, and then they are giving a period of 4 or 5 years where they are functioning as judges. And they are not speaking anything in court or so, but after the proceedings in the courtroom, they together with the two professional judges will sit and discuss if the person is guilty or not. They will discuss what penalty should be given and so on. And the idea is that these lay judges should be able to make sure that there is no corruption and that there is an understanding of how the society works when the decisions are made. Lay judges typically serve one or few days per month if they don't have a very big case, which takes many days. And other ways they can, as I said, serve as witness supporters in between. And this is how it works there. The third place we visited was a jail. This is a jail used before and during the court trial. We met Sevim Aslansad, and we learned about a target to treat people well and young suspects to get support and education. There are different levels of protection when people are locked in this jail. They can be totally isolated so they don't affect the and speak to other people or threat them or make arrangement to have an influence over the trial upcoming. Others are seeing that they will not be able to do that, but they might run away and that they are locked in here in the jail. And thirdly, there are others that do not get locked in. They can stay in the society because they think these people will come to the court when there is a case. And but there is no bail system in Sweden. It's based on the prosecutor's decision, and some longer periods for lock-in has to be also confirmed by the court itself. Finally, we went to the police station. We met a policeman. He's an inspector, Per Lundqvist. This police station covers a big area of the greater Stockholm, and it has also some substations. And we were informed about how they work, including sometimes coordinating with social services, etc. This is just me referring very shortly to what happened this day. Of course, we learned a lot.
We then went to Åland. So on Thursday we was on Åland. Åland is a group of many islands, mostly small islands, which is a part of the and constitute a south western part of Finland, and it has a relatively small population, but they are still big in shipping and in some other areas. And we met Anders Ekström, the managing director of Chamber of Commerce and the business life organization in on these islands. We were also informed about business life on Åland and that some companies are active in or towards India, including a company for some very special plastic material. They also showed us some local products that they recommended, and we saw them also and tested some eatables from that. And we had some very interesting meeting, learning a lot about these islands' business lives. On Thursday afternoon, after lunch, we went to see the Åland's Lagtinget, which is a parliament valid for this group of islands. This group of islands is, as I said, a part of Finland, but has autonomy. We met Susanne Eriksson, who is working at Lagtinget, and it's important to understand the Åland situation and the Finland situation. Actually, if you see the background, Sweden was earlier a big country, including Finland and including in periods also parts of Russia and Baltic states and so on, and also had territories in Germany and so on. Actually, Finland was, you can say, a part of Sweden when Sweden was kind of formed in the 13th, 14th century. And during the history then, there was fightings back and forward. And Finland was an active part, and the soldiers was coming from both Sweden and Finland, and there was fighting and doing things everywhere, and it was coordinating. So Finland was just the eastern part of Sweden, but in the early 19th century, 1807-89, around this time, after a Russian army went into Helsinki and then fooled the Swedish general. It was winter and cold, and the Swedish general was on an island, a fortress which was known as the Gibraltar of the North, which was impossible to take military at that time. But they fooled the Swedish soldiers to believe that Russians had taken Stockholm and that Sweden has fallen in the Russian hands. And they gave up without fighting, so the Russians were able to take that part of Finland. Then the Russians went northwards and lost. And actually the Swedish, who met them first, won a battle, but they were run out of ammunition, so they had to run. So Russians was able to take all of Finland, and then they went to, when there was agreements about the future, Sweden accepted that they took Finland, and Åland, who was a purely Swedish-speaking territory, they wanted to, Sweden wanted to have it, but the Russians say, why should we give away our the keys to the Finland and everything, because it has a very strategic place in the Baltic Sea. And in the end, it was also decided by the Nation United, which was before United Nations, in the early 20th century, that Åland should be part of Finland, but have autonomy, and also no one is allowed to have permanent troops there, not even Finland. So they are a demilitarized zone.
And they are now disallowing it to parliament there. It makes the laws, which are valid only for these islands within the framework of Finland. And they have several municipalities on the island, and some are small, and they are even so small some that they have only a bit over 100 inhabitants. This is a very special background there, but these islands are still very, very successful business-wise and in other ways, and has become an important place for some business and tourism, and they are also a place that, due to agreements with the European Union, that ships that stops at these islands will be able to sell alcoholic drinks and alcoholic bottles without charging any tax. It's tax-free if they stop there. And this is an advantage for the islands. It means there's a lot of ships pass between Sweden and Finland and other places, also stop at these islands, just even if it's only for 15 minutes.
Mastery as short courses, so, and there is in Denmark, I don't know the system, but you can ask when we come to the legal firm there. That is one of the questions I think is relevant to ask, and then we can learn, and then we can see how does it work. It was a case question, because even if you were not doing,
you're making them understand the values that you should not do such crimes, as it won't harm their position but harm the position of the country. So you are more or less working as in together, which is the best thing over here. Like as it is rightly said, united we stand, divided we fall. So your country is joining hands together and making every aspect to come in a rightful position.
Yeah, they are the wealth more than India. I agree with that. But they are more, the another thing is that which is really interesting, that if you want to develop, if any country is developed, it not does the only effort of the government. As well, there are lots of efforts which people of the country had to make. Because if your government providing your rules and regulations, depends on you, it depends on the people of that country, then how they are just help the government to implement those laws so that they can become the development. So there are lots of rules which I really like, that they are even not mentioned in any written form, but they but the people of the Sweden are following them. So
everything, so I'm happy here. It's an eye-opening challenge. I have learned many things, like time punctuality and the prison system over here. The university, the main focus was my university, because I want to learn the LLM over here. So university is really good, teachers are really educated, and this was the intellectual lecture, means person can communicate with them meanwhile the lecture. So this is very appreciable. The greeters like a god, like we say that visitor are the god for us. So say they did the same. So I like it, and many other things like the peace in this country, the law in the country, the road traffic system, even the person wear the helmet in the bicycle. So this is a very great thing, and we want wear the helmet even on the bike or scooty. So they are very law abiding person, and I like them.
Thank you. Sorry, I would like to thank Mam and Sir, both of you, for such a good trip, and of course Mam and Sir for the yesterday talk we had about the European Union and all about the Europe and other countries, and especially about the Sweden and especially for the INBA. I never thought I would ever be
would be coming to Sweden, but after coming here, I regret like why I never come here back, and I never thought about it. So Sweden has even taught me how to be so active and punctual, and of course sir has made me punctual, which I was never been. Like, you have to come at 11, 11 or 10 and 8 every time he says in a group, day before, and I would see such messages and I'm like, oh really, in India back we are not so punctual, but yes, in Sweden you have to be, and even you misses a train, bus, everything. And of course laws are great over here and every people is followed. And moreover, the country present themselves as team, and team stands for together we achieve more, and that's what Sweden is working on. And I must appreciate, and I think even as being Indian we should follow such things. And today I must say, like, we are 7 people over here and we can learn so much things, and we can imply back in India and can talk, can also share such information and knowledge to other people so that they can also imply such things and can make this India a great nation just like Sweden.
Srinivas.
They are actually enjoying.
I don't know if they are enjoying or they are scared. I have no idea. Thank you.
a more appetite from Indian companies to invest here. There is a Danish-Indian Chamber of Commerce, fairly active, and it's about a month ago that they had a big investment seminar talking about Danish and Indian investments. We are in contact on an ongoing basis with some partners from the Indian law firm Dua Associates. They've been here a couple of times over the past few months. Okay. There is a Danish lawyer they have engaged. He works in England for an English law firm, but they've engaged him to sort of be the bridge between Denmark and India. And we are talking about joint seminars for certain business sectors that are of particular interest between Denmark and India, ICT, clean energy, and food, to name a couple of them. Magnusson has 200 lawyers total across the Nordic Baltic Sea region. So we have offices in Denmark, Sweden, Finland, Russia, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and Poland. We also do work for clients in, as I say, many different parts of the world: China, Middle East, India, and the US. It's different systems in terms of law students, but in Denmark, when you have gone 9 or 10 years to school, you go into high school. That's a three-year education. That ends up with a grade, and that grade you need to use to get into law school if you want to go attend law school. You normally have a three-year bachelor degree where you study fixed courses, a number of fixed courses that has to do with constitution law, EU law, the basic principles of commercial law. I think there are it's changed a lot since I was a student. It's been many, many years since I was a student. But there are also some free elective, from some courses you can elect freely, and they would normally be employment law, company law, stuff like that. Once you have your bachelor degree, you go into the master education. That is a total free. You elect your courses for free, and you end up writing a big thesis that is your master thesis. That usually takes 2 years, so a Danish law degree usually takes 5 years total. You have people, myself included, who prolong it, either with half a year or 1 year and some longer, but you can prolong it. While you study in Denmark, you're paid the state education aid. At the moment, it's about 500 euros a month, which is a payment that you receive, you pay taxes from it. But not a lot, because it's kind of, and you can also earn money on the side. And a lot of young students in law school have, you know, they work in supermarkets or stuff. And then gradually, once you have more and more experience with legal issues, you tend to get a relevant job, either as a paralegal in a law firm or working for a company with law, stuff like that. And when you then graduate from law school, if you want to become a lawyer, you have a three-year training period. So you join a law firm, work under a principal in a law firm, and for 3 years, if you make a mistake, it will be his or her problem, not yourself, your own, with the law society. And then you attend courses training you in, money laundering, client handling, financial aspects of running a law firm, and a certain amount of civil procedure in order to train you to become a lawyer. And then you have two exams. One is an oral exam, where you have a number of the courses you've attended that are drawn, and then you are examined in those. And then you either need to have a court case, a real court case, that is then merited as your trial case, and the judges and your counterparty know that is a part of your training period. And if you don't, a lot of firms don't have enough court cases to give to young students. And then the law society organizes instead a mock trial, where two students sort of oppose each other. They have a fictive trial.
Yeah, of course. Proxy. Now I'll get mine. I have some.
Okay. Jeg taler med nogle sange i dag, så det kunne jeg have været der, men ellers må de lige komme op med om 5 minutter.
Okay, ja, det er fint. I kan bare banke på det. Det er sådan rigtig uformelt det her, så det kan bare komme lidt ind. Det er lige okay. But I hope that you will find it interesting, and I'll give the floor to Matthias. As I mentioned, there will be some refreshments. I think it will be coffee and tea. It's perfectly fine to drink all of it. It's and there might even be tap water, which I know is in an Indian context can be a bit delicate, but in Denmark it's very clean, very safe.
I would be focusing on the implementations of the principles, environmental law principles in India. I just have a pool of 5 or 6 pictures, and each picture has a story. So I'd be linking that and would be explaining the scenario in India, like at the start of.
Perfect.
Yeah. Also, like I'm an undergraduate student, and I'm from the University of Petroleum and Energy Studies. So we have disciplines in various fields of law, like environmental laws, energy laws, and corporate laws. So it's the only campus in the north of India which has built a sustainable. It's a green building.
Okay.
So we manage our own water resources because the campus is located in a valley. So water is a very big problem there. So yeah.
What state is it in?
It's in Uttarakhand. It's okay. A newly established state,
okay.
200 kilometers from the capital.
Okay, yeah. North of the capital.
Yeah, north of the capital. In my undergrads, I undertook 2 projects. One which is on both of which are related to environment related issues. So the government of India, it came up with a proposal to merge all the retail outlets of the petroleum industry. For example, all of these petroleum outlets are being managed and administered by the government itself, and there are very few private players in the market, but they don't actually contribute much. So it's the government which actually takes up this petroleum industry. So what government thought was, there are 3-4 government companies which are actually in this petroleum industry, specific to retail market. So in one of its financial budget in the year 2017, it proposed to amalgamate 2-3 companies to create a synergy, and I just undertook a project which was related to what emissions can be saved in such synergies created.
As well as to protect the environment. So he is the best enemy and as well as the best friend of the environment. So let's start.
Good afternoon everyone, here is Gurpreet Kaur, and as my friend had discussed about the situation of India and all of another friends, what is going on in India environmentally and the legal position. I would like to add some more points of that. We are agreeing that we are facing some problems relating to environment because the people are there not compromising with their facilities, and but they don't want to accept that thing. If they want to protect their environment, they have to compromise somewhere. And for that, our government is also doing a lot of things, like there are also tribunals and there are law firms which are creating lots of things and awaring the people that you should do that, you shouldn't do that. But if we thought collectively, we have to preserve our environment. If we are preserving our environment, only that we can give our to our next generation. So that's all of my opinion. Thank you.
Good afternoon, respected sir, ma'am, and delegates. I'm Stramona Mitra, and I'm here on behalf of Indian National Bar Association to deliver a presentation on environmental laws and regulations in India. I'll start off with a brief overview, which includes the definition, followed by this is the mini constitution, 42nd Amendment Act, which deals with environmental laws, followed by fundamental rights, duties, the most important acts that are there within the legal regimen of environment, and lastly violations and the arena of public interest litigation.
greeting for the day, everyone. I would like to thank you all that you have given us your prestige time for giving explaining us about the environment. Firstly, I would like to deal with the environment laws and regulation in India. What is like environment laws and regulation? We have different types of act, different types of laws, different types of regulation which help for the efficient and sustainable development of the environment in our country.
It all began with the concern for public health, welfare, management of water supply and other environmental resources. The rise in awareness began with the environmental degradation which occurs due to rapid urbanization and industrialization of the country. However, from the 1970s, there was a major change in perception at the national and regional level, which brings us to the topic of environmental governance in India.
Secondly, we have environment governance in India. We have the amendment, 42nd amendment. As my friend told, it was the mini constitution amendment where different types of provisions was incorporated in our constitution, which states that every state will have its own rules and regulation to protect, to preserve their environment at any cost. They have to punish the violators, those who do not abide with the rules and regulations laid down under the act.
It is a fundamental duty of every citizen according to Article 51AG of the Indian Constitution to protect and improve the natural environment, the forest, lakes, rivers, wildlife, and to have a compassion for every living creature under the sun.
Fundamental rights. When Constitution provides us the right, we have some duties incorporate with this to do, as rights and duties go both hand in hand. We have the right as it is given under Article 21. Article 21 is the heart of our constitution. It is right to life and personal liberty. Under this article, it has been laid down that we have the right to enjoy the complete and entire wholesome environment and introduce stiffer penalties for those, again, who violates the law. Greetings for the day, sir and ma'am. Thank you so much, sir and ma'am, for making this trip a memorable trip. And thank you, Puneet sir, for organizing such a great trip. Without your responsibilities and care, this would not be achieved. And sir, your efforts has made us learn a lot. Your efforts of arranging so much of great meetings with others and opportunity for presenting a lecture on environment was a great thing. That is in itself an honor thing. Thank you, ma'am. It was really a memorable trip and we find a lot of good friends. And the most thing I like over here is the greeting. Everyone gives you the warm welcome. It's a cultural diversity country and we loved a lot and I learned. I'm going back with a bag full of knowledge. I'll try to implement this knowledge in others and hoping forward for the trip of IMBA that we can join this thing again. And it's a very knowledgeable trip. Thank you, ma'am and sir. Thank you so much. Bye!
Hello, I'm Gurpreet Kaur and I would like to thank you, Indian National Bar Association, as well as sir and ma'am and including Puneet sir, that they have providing us that platform. So where we have learned a lot with enjoying our trip and we learn a lot, that's all. And I think I don't need to explain anything else because my friend had explained already. So I would like to recommend to all law students that stop wishing and
start doing.
Thank you, bye bye.
Thank you for making my dreams come true of visiting Europe, of creating the cobbled streets and trying out new cuisines and of course visiting new offices. And last but not the least, and then the most important part of the trip, we all got to represent our country, represent our colleges and stand for delivering a presentation on environmental science, of course. So stop wishing and start doing, because that's what INBA is for. Thank you.
And it was great to be in Europe and especially this opportunity is provided by INBA, and I would like to thank sir and ma'am for everything they are doing for us, and especially Puneet sir for such great arrangement, and he arranged every meetings and food and everything for us, and everything. It was a great companionship with you all guys. I would miss you after this trip, and especially INBA. I would thank to INBA. It's a tagline which says, start doing and stop wishing. And that's what I'm doing.
The Nordic chair as well as India for making this trip a great success. It was a great learning experience. And thank you for making this dream coming to Europe true. I would like to conclude by saying that start doing and stop wishing.
I'm very happy to be a part of INBA and this Europe tour, and I would like to thank you, Puneet sir, Abhok sir, ma'am, and all the team and all the friends. They make me feel very happy. So I would like to see you all that you should also join this group. So stop wishing and start. Thank you.
Puneet Kumar, and I'm chairperson of International Power Station Student Section, and I would firstly like to thank Kaviraj sir, the Secretary General of International Bar Association, to provide such an amazing opportunity to visit Europe and have such amazing meetings. And I would like to thank Ubok sir and Meenakshi ma'am for such a beautiful arrangements. And stop wishing, start doing.